And welcome to the 34th meeting in 2023 of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. The first item on our agenda today is an evidence session with the Scottish Fiscal Commission to discuss the Scottish Budget 24-25 and the Commission's December 2023 Economic and Fiscal Forecasts, which were both published yesterday. We are joined today by Professor Graham Roy, Chair, Professor David Ulph, Commissioner, and online, Claire Murdoch, Head of Fiscal Sustainability and Public Funding, Scottish Fiscal Commission. And the reason she's joining us remotely is sadly due to COVID, but I'm glad that Claire is able to participate today. So welcome everyone to the meeting and invite Professor Roy to make a brief opening statement. Good morning, Professor Roy.
Good morning, and thank you, Convener. Our report yesterday said that economic growth will remain fragile in the near term, and as indicated last year, we believe that living standards are set to fall between 2021, 2022 and 2023, 2024, and won't return to pre-cost of living crisis levels until 2026, 2027. And inflation is expected to remain above target for longer than we previously forecast last December. Against this backdrop, the Scottish Government's budget is set to increase next year by £1.3 billion from the latest figure for 2023-2024, as an increase of 2.6% in cash terms, or 0.9% after inflation. And most of this increase comes from income tax. An element of this follows from the new tax band for those earning over £75,000, an additional penny on the top rate. But a larger part comes from the relatively strong earnings growth we're seeing at the moment and the fiscal drag that's leading to from the fixed key cash thresholds. And we predict continued significant growth in the number of higher rate taxpayers in Scotland, many of whom will be seeing increase in the proportion of their income subject to higher rates. However, despite these funding increases, there's little space for new spending once we take account of pressures such as the ongoing consequences of changes to devolved social security payments and the linking of payment rates to inflation. Other policies such as the council tax freeze and public sector pay have further added to existing spending commitments. Now, understandably, a lot of attention is focused, as I've done so far, on next financial year, so I'd just like quickly to extend that discussion to take in the remaining 4 years. Between 2023-2024 and 2028-2029, total funding for both resource and capital is expected to increase by 14% in nominal terms and 4% in real terms. However, within that, capital funding is expected to fall by 20% in real terms over the same period. I think it's useful to look at what's determining the outlook for growth and resource funding and some of the risks that are associated with that. Beyond 2024-2025, the resource block grant from the UK Government is expected to grow by just 1% a year in real terms on average, and the capital block grant is expected to fall in real terms, all in line with the UK Government medium-term spending plans. But crucially, the UK Government has not set departmental spending plans for 2025-2026 onwards, despite these overall totals. So there's risks in there for the Scottish Government in terms of how these spending patterns might evolve, and the OBR and others have highlighted the risks associated with these totals. The income tax net position is currently projected to contribute to real terms growth in the Scottish Budget. As we set out last year, the scale of the Government policies to raise revenues since 2018 through the creation of higher rates and new bands, but crucially freezing the higher rate threshold below that in the UK, should lead to a positive net tax position in the years ahead, given the effects of fiscal drag. That net tax position will rise. From 2025-2026 onwards, however, the exact scale of that positive net tax position becomes more uncertain. Part of the ongoing growth is due to our slightly higher forecast for earnings growth in Scotland compared to the equivalent forecast by the OBR for the UK. And we therefore flag a downside risk that if earnings growth in Scotland turn out to be more similar to the UK, then that income tax net position from 2025-2026 onwards could be lower than currently projected. And finally, the only part of the Scottish Government's spending plans which we forecast is Social Security. We're expecting spending to rise from £6.3 billion next year to £8 billion in 2028-2029. This is largely a result of payment rates being uprated by inflation and higher spending on disability payments, which reflect both a UK-wide increase in the number of people receiving disability payments and the effect of the Scottish Government's policies and operational changes to disability payments. Thank you, Convener.
OK, thank you very much for that very helpful opening statement. I'm just going to turn straight to your report. So the questions I'll be asking will be mostly based on that report. So, for example, in question 6, the of your report, the summary, introduction, in the very first sentence you talk about the Scottish Government's budget for next year set to increase by £1.3 billion from the latest position for 23-24, and go on to say a rise of 2.6% in cash terms or a 0.9% rise after accounting for inflation. Now, this is always a bit of a bugbear, the rate of inflation, because it assumes a GDPR deflator inflation, am I right, of 1.7%. But that doesn't really bear any relationship to real inflation in terms of its impact on the Scottish budget, because more than half the Scottish budget is actually salaries, and that they're increasing by significantly higher than 1.7%. So why does the assumption continue to be 1.7%, given how the differential between GDPR deflator and CPI inflation?
A few things in that. So it's a very good point. So the GDP, so usually in normal times, the GDP deflator and the CPI inflation rate are very similar to one another. So this issue about the differential doesn't always come up as being a particular issue. In most cases, the standard way of assessing the impact of inflation and government spending is to use the GDP deflator, because it essentially measures how much is being spent. And again, that's standard practice. But you're right, particularly when you have pay awards being a significant driver of spending profiles, then it's much more appropriate to use the CPI inflation rate to think about how this is impacting on people's living standards. So you get this differential between the GDP deflator and the CPI inflation rate. The reason we use the GDP deflator is that standard practice. It's the rate that the government would use. It's the rate that the UK use, OBR use. So it's largely done for consistency of that. But you're right to highlight at particular points in time there will be differentials, which will mean that choices made on pay awards, for example, will look different to the overall inflation rate that is capturing total government spend.
Yeah, because we're talking about real terms increase, in resource, but it's not really a real terms increase in actual fact in the real world, if you're actually talking about using a deflator, which is so far below what wage settlements are, for example, is it?
Yeah, and we had a similar thing, if you recall, last year about the differential between GDP deflator and CPI because of the effects of energy prices and imports, and that was one of the big drivers of inflation. Mm-hmm. So the GDP deflator was lower than the CPI rate of inflation. As I said, in time these will start to move back into line with one another, and there will be a better reflection mm-hmm. of the different components of that. Because if we were to use CPI, for example, then all the stuff that government spends and purchases would be using too high an inflation rate, and that's just one of the trade-offs that you have when you've got this differential, and that's why we use the GDP deflator, larger because of standard practice.
Yeah, I mean, obviously I know it's standard practice. It just seems to me quite frustrating that it's not a figure that seems to be based as much in reality as one would wish, certainly not in these difficult times. Now, in terms of fiscal overview, you talk about resource funding rising by 8% to 28-29, but in the figures that, it's on page 3, but when you look at the figures on page 5, unless my arithmetic is wrong, you've got the actual funding increasing from 52.449 to 54.691. So that's actually an increase of 4.2% rather than 8% by that measure, in real terms. So it's not 8%.
Can you say that again, please? Just
so yeah, so you said resource funding rises by 8%, 28-29. But actually, the actual figures on page 5, the second line, seems to be a 4.2% rise or an 8% rise. I'm just wondering why that is.
Are you looking at figure 2.1?
Sorry?
Are you looking at figure 2.1?
Yeah, this figure doesn't have a number on it. It's on page 5 of your actual report. So it's right at the very beginning of your report on page 5 of it. Sorry? I think Claire wants to come in here.
Yeah, sorry. So one is... The 8% relates to resource. Mm-hmm. So, that's total. So one of the big things that you're seeing is resource going up, but a significant fall in capital spending.
I assumed that was resource only. I didn't realise that was capital and resource combined.
Yeah, so that top line is total. So
right, okay.
It's the resource that's going up 8%. And that's actually one of the really interesting things that you're seeing in the budget. So resource is going up. We might come on to this about what this in terms of the net tax position. But the significant fall in capital, so we talk about a fall in capital of about 20% in real terms over the time period, and that's what drags what you think is an 8% for resource. What is an 8% for resource? Once you go to the total, it drags it down.
Yeah, it was interesting because the Deputy First Minister talked about a 10% reduction over 5 years rather than 20% yesterday in her statement, which I thought was odd given the figures that you actually used, because I didn't see your figures until after the statement, you know, so otherwise I would have asked why she had actually done that, but that's interesting. Now, in terms of income tax, one of the issues, of course, which has been very much to the forefront has been the kind of new additional rate. It starts at £75,000 a year. Now, you've assumed that that will produce £82 million net, but gross, it's £200 million. Would that be right? So basically what you're saying is that of the £200 million, which on paper is being levied by that change, will actually bring in only 41%, £82 million. Would that be right?
Yes.
Just to be clear, the figures we're talking about there are the impact of both reintroduction of this new tax rate and the increase in the top rate from 47% to 48%. So it's the combined impact of both of those changes that we're forecasting there. So we're saying the gross impact is around £200 million and the net impact is about £82 million once you net off behavioural effects.
And how accurate do you feel that your predictions are likely to be in with regard to that? What's the kind of margins of error in terms of that? I mean, I would have thought they could be quite wide, really.
So a couple of things I would say on this. So one is, we've had this discussion before about tax elasticities and the challenges about estimating tax elasticities. So we've not changed our approach this time around. So these numbers are what you'd expect to see from all our work in the past around what the behavioural effects might be. And they're very, you know, and the government use these sorts of things when they do their illustrative tax calculator to show what the effects of these policies are. So in many ways, they're not surprising in the sense that these are exactly what you should be seeing with our assumptions. So you'll recall back in, I think it was March 2018, we published a report into how we estimate behavioural change and tax elasticities. And there we walk through the fact that that in order to come up with these tax elasticities, what we've done is looked at a lot of the academic evidence, a lot of the studies that look at what happens, particularly within countries when you start changing tax rates, but also what happens in the UK. Of course, the question and why there's an element of uncertainty is that none of them are Scotland, and you're having to rely on looking at evidence from elsewhere, and we then make judgment calls about what ones might be approximate and accurate to the Scottish context. So we do highlight there's a level of uncertainty in that, and we are then ex-ante estimating what the behavioural effects might be. Clearly, over time, what we would want to do, and it started with a report HMRC did, I think, a couple of years ago, is to start to try and work out ex post whether or not these tax elasticities are in the margin they should be in. So they published a report, I think, in December 2021, where they looked at, I think, 18, 19, and looked to see whether or not, from their evidence, they could look at the tax elasticities. And they also highlight how difficult it is, because trying to estimate what people's behaviour was and would have been, you have to think about what the counterfactual would be, and that gets very complex and very difficult. And there are statistical methods you could use. Long story short was that the estimated tax elasticities are not too dissimilar to what we use at the moment. So at this moment in time, based on looking at academic evidence and also what we've got in terms of the studies so far, that we think these tax elasticities are the best ones to use, but it's clearly something where we are very open about and happy to consult on, and as new evidence emerges, we'll amend them as we go.
And just to add to that, we haven't seen any evidence in past behaviour that says, oh, we missed something really important there. So we've had significant changes in tax over the last few years, and we haven't seen anything in the data that says, well, there's a big surprise here. We've seen a change in tax or change in tax revenue that lies way outside what we thought it would have been. So there's nothing there standing out in the data that tells us that we're significantly offline here with this. But I do take your point that there are uncertainties about this, but we think our judgments have been borne out.
Yeah, I mean, that's really what we're looking at, I think, is the issue of how accurate this has been by looking at how behavioural change has impacted in previous years in terms of your forecasts. I mean, some of the forecasts, actually, I mean, they seem to have been quite pessimistic compared to others. I mean, for example, it now seems that we're going to have a positive reconciliation in 25-26 of some £732 million. I mean, that seems to be quite very optimistic compared to what was predicted before. So what kind of explanation do you have for that?
So just come back to it on the behavioural point. There's an interesting box in 4.2 where we walk through the effects of behavioural stuff. And in there, we talk about the assumptions and the uncertainties in there. So one final point I'd make about just the tax policy that's been introduced just now. It's important to put... You know, we're estimating 80 million rather than 200 million, but 200 million in a context of nearly £20 billion worth of total revenues. These are relatively small. You could change these assumptions significantly, but they wouldn't actually have much of an impact on overall income tax revenues. So there's just there's a point about expectations and assumptions about using different tax elasticities. You know, when you're talking about these particular tax policies, it won't dramatically change income tax revenues given the scales of the magnitudes that are involved. But just picking up then, therefore, on your point about
You're talking about 0.4% of income tax revenues. That's 82 million.
And we'll maybe come on to this. What is driving the big growth in income tax? It isn't these tax individual tax policies. It's earnings growth and fiscal drag. That's what is generating the significant amount.
Yeah.
So on your specific point about the 700 million revision So there's a few things I would say. So the easiest way probably to think about this is that so we've revised up our income tax forecast based on last year about 2.2 billion. But 1.5 billion of that is essentially similar trends across the UK. Mm-hmm. So the OBR have raised significantly up income tax because earnings have been growing much more quickly than expected, in part because of inflation. All this feeds through to that. Once you add in fiscal drag, you get really significant growth in income tax revenues. So that's the first point. So that then leaves the 700 million, which then relates to that improvement in our forecast and therefore the improvement in net position. And there's a couple of things I would say that help understand that. So the first thing is you'll remember back in July, we had better than expected outturn data for Scotland for 2020-2021. That then was when HMRC came and said this is their final outturn data of income tax receipts in Scotland, and that was up by about 390 million. We explain a bit about where that variation has come from. Part of it was an error in the way that HMRC were presenting the statistics for the previous year, which was about over 100 million. So that explains one of the reasons, remember, we were puzzled when we met, I think, in September about why there was such a gap between what we were thinking RTI data would give us and what actually happened. Some of that was because the statistics were miscalculated for the previous year, and HMRC have now corrected that. So we now have more accurate statistics in that context. So that was part of it. Then part of it was then also emerging evidence we were getting of Scottish earnings growth outperforming the rest of the UK. That's continued into this year, and we have a discussion of earnings growth in Scotland in our economy session. There's a really interesting chart on figure 3.22, where you see the differential in earnings growth between Scotland and the UK, and Scotland moving ahead of the UK. And when we come on to why we think that is potentially the case. But we started to identify that in May. Once we then calculated that in, that then explains the remaining 300 million, which gives you your 700 million. So some of it is the outturn data that we now have, which has lifted up the level. And the second part is a judgment by us that actually this data we're seeing on earnings in Scotland is actually real, and that leads to us being able to be more optimistic about the earnings growth coming through.
Yeah, I mean 3.47, for example, you talk about, pay in the finance sector in Scotland being 3.5, growing 3.5% faster than the rest of the UK, and you also talk about, for example, North Sea Oil, where there was a kind of drag in terms of earnings for a while, coming back up to the kind of average. Just wonder if you can talk to us a wee bit about that and the circumstances around that, and why that's happening, and if it's likely to continue.
Yeah, so a couple of things that I think are worth maybe bringing David as well for his reflections, but there's some really interesting data. So if you look at RTI data for average earnings growth for 2022-2023, for Scotland it's 6.3%, for the UK it's 5.9%. If you look at ASH, which is the annual survey of hourly earnings, which is the main ONS publication on weekly earnings, for last year, they show growth in Scotland of 9.7% and 6.2% in the UK. And Scotland was actually the highest of any region or nation within the UK. So we started to see this in May, which is one of the reasons why we uplifted our forecast. But actually, all the evidence we've had since then backs up our assessment that earnings growth in Scotland in the last year into the current year is running ahead of the UK. And we then speculate about some of the reasons. So one of the reasons why we were more pessimistic before was because we're saying all the evidence has pointed to the northeast of Scotland lagging behind. If you look at the charts that I was talking about there, actually the northeast is now back online again. Yeah. So it's come back on stream. And then secondly, in financial services as well, again, the differences in the financial services industry, you see Scotland slightly different financial services to the UK. So when interest rates are rising in the UK, you don't have that same huge growth in financial services there. I mean, one final point, maybe just bring in David for his thoughts on this. I think one interesting thing that this leads to is that the power of earnings growth to drive income tax revenues is really significant. And maybe David will talk a bit about some of the rules of thumb that we have. But very small relative changes in earnings growth when you're fixing thresholds and relative performance to the UK has a dramatic effect in terms of income tax revenues relative to changes in policy in that regard. And one final thing I would just say as well is that the number of 700 million sounds a lot, and it's a big number, but we're thinking that income tax is going to be essentially double in terms of revenues by the end of this forecast type period than where they were in 2016, 2017. So we all have to uplift our number because of the effects of inflation. Something that was maybe 300 million last time is now going to be 600 million simply because of the effects of inflation here.
Okay, David. Add a few points to that. One was, we actually spent a lot of time digging into other evidence, not just from data sources, but from surveys that were being done. And there was a huge amount of evidence we saw that suggested that labour markets in Scotland were tighter than labour markets in the UK as a whole. That's what supported our view, that there was this relative earnings growth in Scotland because of these tighter labour markets. And another factor that we took into account here was that there's a difference between the financial sector in Scotland compared to the financial sector in the rest of the UK. In Scotland, the financial sector is more heavily dominated by work and pensions and insurance, where returns are fairly steady and earnings are very steady. In London and the South East, the financial sector is more heavily represented in areas of investment where returns are more volatile, and so earnings are more volatile through, for example, being related to bonus pay. So you could see consistent growth, steady growth in Scotland, and just a bad year for bonuses in the rest of the UK. Mm. So these are some of the factors we were looking at in trying to think through why is earnings growth in Scotland so strong relative to the rest of the UK. But I just want to put in front of the committee two stylized facts which may help you to think both about why we've seen this growth in tax revenue, but also policies that you might want to think about to continue that growth in earnings in tax revenue. So one stylized fact is this. Because Scotland has a really quite progressive tax system now, for every 1% by which earnings grow faster in Scotland than in the rest of the UK, net tax revenue will go up by 250 million. So that's a figure we've calculated, just doing some calculations of supposing earnings growth was this in Scotland, earnings growth was that in the rest of the UK. What does that do to net tax revenue? So for every 1 percentage point higher in Scotland, you get £250 million additional net tax revenue from that, because of the Scottish tax system is already a very progressive tax system, but also because it's a more progressive tax system than the rest of the UK. Every 1 percentage point growth in earnings in Scotland generates £25 million more tax, net tax revenue than in the rest of the UK, so just because it's a more progressive tax system. So because it's absolutely very progressive, and because it's relatively more progressive, you get to see all these strong effects of both any earnings growth and any differential earnings growth in Scotland compared to the rest of the UK. So promoting earnings growth is a very powerful way of driving up tax revenue in Scotland. The more we can get earnings to grow faster in Scotland, the more we can get tax revenues to grow.
Yeah, fiscal drag and rising earnings.
It's not fiscal drag, this is just the effects.
But fiscal drag is the reason, to a large extent, why also there's a, you know, the forecast is £2,211 million higher now than it was a year ago. I want to go back to capital a minute. I mean, I only want to ask questions for another 3-4 minutes because I've got colleagues keen to come in. What's the impact on growth, medium to long term, of this reduction in capital? Because 20% real terms reduction, even if we accept the GDP deflator, you know, in reality it's completely different. But assuming we accept that that is a real figure, that's still a 20% reduction in capital over 5 years. What's going to be the impact on growth and productivity over that kind of hit to capital?
Yeah, so you're right. So We talk a bit about this in terms of our capital assessment. So in when we look at the overall assessment about what this might mean for the economy, and we highlight that the key thing that's driving the fall in capital is the block grant. The government can do some borrowing around the edges around that, but the big money is
90% from the UK.
Yeah. So you can borrow more, but actually at the end of the day it comes through the block grant. So this actually reflects a trend across the UK and the falling UK. And it's quite interesting that at the UK level, the plans for capital spending will see capital spending as a share of UK GDP fall from 3.5% to 3%. Over the next 5 years. And the OBR noted that should this be delivered, that around half of the rise in investment as a share of the British economy since 2019-20 would be reversed. So it's quite a significant shift in the amount of capital investment that is going into the UK economy if these projections hold true. And that's essentially because the government are essentially flatlining in cash terms, the UK government flatlining in cash terms, capital borrowing. So, you know, as economists, capital investment has a huge, spent wisely, has a huge impact on the economy. It connects communities. It means that business can become more productive. It means that connectivity, both from within the UK and outside the UK, can be better. So it has all the evidence points to capital investment being a really important part of economic growth in the long run. Clearly, ministers at the UK level are balancing act that they're working on between how they balance the books and how they can bring the deficit down and what effects that might have on the economy over the long run if you don't do that, versus then where do you put the balance of that adjustment? And they've put the balance of adjustment on capital spending, but that will have an impact on the long-term infrastructure and potential long-term growth in Scotland.
OK, and just lastly for me, at the moment, in terms of the autumn statement, I mean, basically the UK government really didn't go beyond 24-25. Mm-hmm. And what impact has that had in terms of your own forecasting for Scotland?
So it adds in...
So it adds in an additional layer of uncertainty. We have broad high-level totals for what they've said about resource spending, but we don't have the spending, the departmental spending elements within that. We do have indications of the current UK government about on things like defence and overseas development, which then lets you do some calculations about what this might mean for individual spending portfolios. But it does mean that it looks exceptionally tight over the five-year period about what the block grant might look like. Again, we highlight in our report the OBR have said that if you look at what happens in the past, then you get the sense that such spending plans would be exceptionally tight, and on the balance of probability, it's more likely that future UK governments would spend more than what are these in the plan. So we highlight that as a potential positive risk to the Scottish budget coming down the line. But clearly it's a risk. Clearly clearly the UK government could choose not to change their plans, and then that would lead to more challenging settlements further for the Scottish government.
Okay, thank you. I'm now going to open up Michelle to be followed by Ross.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I'm just going to focus on one point because there's a lot of areas to get round, and I know everyone wants to come in. It's going back to the behavioural change, and I fully accept what you're saying and the figures that the Convener's already brought out, but the point you're making about it is relatively small to the overall income tax base. But, of course, I mean, as I understand it, your modelling is based on just those people who might be impacted, but I'm interested in exploring the kind of second round effects, if you like, against the challenge of counterfactuals. And it was actually, I picked up on something that Professor David Bell had commented this morning. He said, my concern is that it will be difficult to attract the workers and investment to Scotland that are needed to generate sufficient growth. And I suppose that's a sentiment that's been expressed elsewhere. Rather than imagining that people are going to leave, in fact, it might be that people just don't come, and that's one possible scenario, of which there's a multitude in them. So I'd like to hear a bit more of your thinking about how you've reflected on that at the kind of big picture level.
Yeah. Do you want to go first, David?
Yes, I mean, we have thought about both of those dimensions here, both the impact of the differential tax between Scotland and the rest of the UK on people's decisions to move away from Scotland or to move their tax position away from Scotland, but also deterring people who might otherwise have chosen to come to Scotland to come to Scotland. Again, I go back to the point I made earlier on. If we were seriously wrong on this, we would have seen, I think, something in the data already. You know, that we would have seen some impacts on tax revenue that we just haven't seen because of the previous changes that have been made here.
I mean, you're looking at the data that's coming through, and I heard Professor Roy saying that earlier, looking at past evidence. But I suppose what I'm trying to explore is, and I don't mean in terms of Laffer curve tipping point, but a perception around Scotland as a place to invest. Does this change things at all?
And that's certainly something we have thought about quite a bit, that it could be there's a cumulative effect of lots and lots of changes. Mm. And at some point people say, OK, I now see what it's going to be like if I were to move to Scotland. I see what it's going to be like if I stay down south in England. I now see the picture more clearly, and I'll make a decision not to move. So it's the kind of straw that breaks the camel's back kind of effect that it kicks in after a period of time, and it definitely changes people's minds about coming here. But again, we haven't seen a lot of that in the data. When we look at net migration, there is quite a lot of inward migration into Scotland, and a lot of that comes from relatively high-income people. So these might be people who are retiring to Scotland. So there would be an issue there in terms of their contribution to GDP. Mm-hmm. There might be an impact there. But the impact on tax revenue might not be so great if they have significant pension income, that's going to be taxed at these high rates. It's something we thought about.
Yeah, and you kind of bring out something else. I mean, people will say that net migration from the rest of the UK into Scotland is higher than the other way around, but I suppose the question is, well, if that is true, but what is the nature of that inward migration in terms of the implications on tax and investment? And I appreciate we don't have the answers here. It's just trying to get more reflections on the table, because the problem is we don't know what will be true until after the event.
Yep.
And I think that's one of the real challenges. This is a really interesting kind of research question about how you do this. So what is the counterfactual? So who are the people who may have come who don't come, or who are the people who come because actually they want to come to a country where you have additional investment in public services? Mm-hmm. There are all these things which what that counterfactual is, you can't experiment. We can't test it and see how people respond. But you can do. I mean, I think as we're now into a number of years now of having collecting data to see that, you can actually start to look at particular aspects of that question. So you're seeing people moving more money into pensions in Scotland relative to the rest of the UK. You're seeing, you know, higher earners changing their hours worked relative to elsewhere in the rest of the UK. Can you start to pick up evidence about levels of investment, etc., flowing in? It's quite difficult for us to do within our remit and resources, because we're very much focused on what is happening next year, and everything else that's happened before is baked in to our baseline, and we look at the change there. But we do say in the report that this is something we think government and others should look at, and it is a really important question, and it's the sort of thing that would really help us in that then we can then make, particularly for our longer term work, is we could then say, look, this is the effects of these policy decisions over not just what's happening next year, when someone's behaviour might not be able to change that much, but actually where investment decisions, location decisions take place, but there happen to be 5-10 years over time.
Okay. But just one other point to add to that is that the way we analyse this and we think about it in terms of doing our calculations is we look at what's called taxable income. So we don't try to go down to the minutiae of, does this affect people's hours of work, or does it affect the decision of how many weeks they work in the year? Does it affect the amount they put into pensions? Does it affect the amount of tax avoidance or other types of tax behaviour they engage in? All we look at is what's the effect on taxable income, which pulls together all those different ways in which people might respond to differential tax positions between Scotland and the rest of the UK. And we use elasticities for taxable income, which are towards the high end of those that are out there in the data, because we do recognise that for some high income people in Scotland, they may have properties both in Edinburgh and down in London, so they can change their tax residence relatively easily. So we tend to use higher elasticities to reflect that possibility. But that's just a judgment. It's not based on a detailed, minute analysis that will support that.
Yeah. We all agree it's a problem. We don't know.
Yep.
OK, thank you, convener.
OK, Ross, before my list.
Thanks. Thank you, convener. I'd like to stick with the question around behavioural effect for a minute, but from a different perspective, because I'm somewhat struggling to square the circle between the amount of time, airspace, political debate spent on the risk of negative behavioural effect from income tax changes compared to the data we now have from 5 years of increasingly significant divergence. You know, despite that increasing divergence in that more progressive system, we've seen growth in earnings, thus direct growth in income tax receipts. David, as you point out, we still have net positive migration into Scotland from the rest of the UK. We do very well for foreign direct investment compared to everywhere other than the London, I believe. Are we overestimating? Are we spending too much time? Are we being disproportionate in the amount of time that we spend discussing the potential negative behavioural effects of income tax divergence compared to other factors that affect the budget in a much greater way? Because as you point out, Graham, we're talking about relatively small numbers in the grand scheme of a £60-ish billion budget.
Yeah. So
So I guess, first of all, I don't control the political discourse about where people are. And I was making a very similar point to you on one of the phone-in programmes this morning, making the point that you have to look at both sides of the balance sheet. That's what determines behaviour. So if you're raising, so our net tax position, we're projecting £1.4 billion next year. Clearly, what do you spend that money on matters for people's decisions. It matters for the economy. It matters for the perception of Scotland. And it's which effect balances itself out. What we do is do our best to come up with a behavioural estimate about what we think the tax policy will raise as people respond to that individual tax decision. So whether you choose to put, if you're fortunate to be in that 100,000 to the 125,000 bracket where you're losing the personal allowance and you're facing a marginal tax rate of nearly 70%, do you put more money into your pension or not? That's the type of things that we're trying to capture. What the effect is on the long-term structural growth rate of Scotland's economy is not what we're looking at in that context. And you're right, for the first few years of tax devolution, we saw the net tax position in quite a precarious state relative to what it was, and that was because earnings growth in Scotland was lagging the UK. But that had much more to do with what's happening in the North East and the performance of Scotland's economy than any evidence we've seen at the time and since then about what was happening in terms of relative tax differential. And I guess that comes back to the point that David was making, which I think is really important in all of this, is that you're right, there is a debate about these marginal changes in taxation, which I get, they're important. But the big thing that drives us is earnings. And if you grow your earnings, either at a higher level, as the UK does, Scotland will get more revenues because of the progressive system and fiscal drag. And if you grow more quickly than the rest of the UK, you'll generate much more revenues than you would do from introducing a new additional rate at 75,000. So earnings in the economy is key.
Thanks. Yeah, that... Oh, sorry, David.
I just said earlier, that stylised fact I gave you of every 1% by which earnings grow faster in Scotland than the rest of the UK increases net tax revenue by £250 million. Just keep that fact in your mind when you're thinking about a lot of these issues. It's a really important number.
Yeah, that then draws us into the debate around the fiscal framework and whether relative tax growth was the best measurement from Scotland's perspective. But that's something we've discussed before, and I'm sure we will continue discussing for some time to come. On there's an interesting reference in, I think it's box 4.2 of your paper, around the behavioural effects and how you measure them, mitigate for them, estimate. And it references the HMRC report from, I think, 2021 on behavioural effect in Scotland. I remember that report, but I can't remember why HMRC did it, essentially. Is that something that they do on a cyclical basis, and should we expect another one, or was that one off?
So it was an occasional paper that they did, I think, for 2018-19. But I know that they're collecting longitudinal data, which will let people do this sort of work much more into the future. And so it's the sort of thing that government working with HMRC can actually do these sorts of assessments and projects to look at what these behavioural effects will be. And I think the thing is, for us that's brilliant. So if we can update our behavioural estimates with estimates that are based upon Scottish data, and you can see the unique effects in Scotland, then we'll update our forecast. But nothing in that study suggested that what we were doing was wrong.
Yeah, I think if HMRC are at some point in the short to medium term producing more longitudinal data, it might actually be worth the committee getting in touch with them to ask about what the timescale for that is, because it would inform quite a lot of our work. That box also mentions the extent to which the USA and Switzerland are relied upon, because there's such a rich evidence base in both of those countries. What kind of evidence gathering work, what kind of studies are not taking place, have not taken place in Scotland, that obviously have in other jurisdictions, that we could be, either government could commission or independent organisations could be encouraged to undertake?
So in our paper back in 2018, we reviewed the entire literature, which looked at not just places like USA and Switzerland for within-country changes in behaviour, but actually at a national level. So there was a study that IFS and others have done looking at the introduction of the 50p rate in the UK and things like that. So we can draw on that. So there's a question about how comparable are the USA and Switzerland to Scotland. So that's a challenge. How comparable is a UK-wide system to Scotland? So that's just why we're having to use judgment in there. I think the key is that as we now have, taxpayer data for Scottish taxpayers and taxpayer data for UK taxpayers, you can use sophisticated techniques to identify similar taxpayers in Scotland and the rest of the UK and control for everything else and then see, are there differences in behaviours in people living in Scotland relative to living in the rest of the UK that you can then attribute to the changes in tax policy up or down? And that, I think that's the bit which I think is the really, as we get more data, is a really positive bit, and we will be able to do it. But government needs, it's kind of difficult for us to do it. It really needs government and others to work on that.
And do...
So can I just say that, go back to Michelle's point, that you need data on two different aspects here. How people respond to differences in taxes conditional on where they actually choose to live. So people living in a particular area might respond to the tax they face in that area through savings decisions, work decisions, tax avoidance decisions. And by looking at people in different parts of the country but who are facing different rates because there are local powers on taxes, you can pick up some of those effects. The more complicated issues, how do you pick up the migration effects and decisions for people to move between one area and another because of these tax differences? And there you need data on movements of population. You can't just study the people who happen to be in that particular region at that particular time. So you need a combination of quite rich data sources to do this.
Absolutely. Thanks very much. That's all for me, Convener.
OK, thank you. Liz to be followed by Michael.
Thank you. Can I start on what I think is a very technical point, but can I just ask a question? You have the forecast for median earnings in Scotland for 24-25 at £28,200, when the ONS data said the same thing for this current year. They had the median salary at 29,675. I'm just wondering what the difference would be there.
Is that is the ONS figure for Scotland and for
yes.
the same year?
Yep.
I need to get back to you on that.
It seemed a bit strange that because I would have thought that was relatively easy to work that out.
Yeah.
But if you could get back, that would be extremely helpful. Can I just ask about this business about the nominal? The gap between private and public sector earnings, because it seems to be widening as far as I can work out. Could you give us a bit of a background on that?
In terms of the differences between public and private,
yeah,
more generally
around
that?
It seems to be
that.
Moving apart quite a bit. Is that correct?
So it tends to ebb and flow over time, and this is a UK effect as well. It tends to ebb and flow at particular points in time. So, and part of that is into levels of unionisation, etc., and things like that, which have an impact. So you see, particularly during downturns, public sector wages tend to stick higher than private sector wages during a downturn, or in terms of high inflation environments, public sector wages tend to be better. But that gap then typically tends to close over time. So on average, and this is where it depends whether you're using median and mean and the distribution of that, on average, so the median public sector wages tend to be higher than the median wages in the private sector, because the private sector has a larger number of very low-paid jobs, but it also has a very small number, but much greater number of very, very, very high-paid jobs. So if you look at median, the public sector wages, typically average salary is higher than in the private sector. But it does, as you say, it does widen and close over time, depending on how the economy is doing.
And does that also reflect how different sectors in the economy are doing then?
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So, and part of it is how quickly they respond to it. So public sector wages tend to be negotiated and set for the period ahead.
And so if the government are thinking now, they're thinking now about a wage policy for 24-25. If you're in the private sector, then you're probably thinking about what your wage policy is for the next few months, and or what might be happening to your employment, because it's much more volatile. So again, one of the things that you typically see is that when you're in a downturn, public sector wages take much longer to adjust and then lag any recovery, whereas private sector wages are much more volatile over the time period.
Yeah. It obviously, one of the things we're trying to drill down on as a committee is where we think the greatest potential for economic improvement in productivity and economic growth is. And therefore, these gaps are quite important, I think.
I mean, just another thing as well, just to broaden out the conversation, I think is really important, is that we've got a line there about the report that says about half of the resource budget of the devolved resource budget is pay. So clearly, if that resource budget is going up by just over 3%, then any pay awards above 3% mean that the remaining half of the budget has to go up by less than 3%.
Yep.
And we also have a table in there where we show what happens if you strip out NDR income and Social Security, and actually the resource budget is actually going down next year. And that's a really difficult decision for the public sector, because if inflation is 3%, then anything lower than 3% is potentially a real terms cut in salary. But anything, but if your half your budget is wages and everything else is under pressure, then where do you find additional funding?
Yeah, you've just answered very helpfully my next question about that, because that leads on to the potential for public sector reform, etc., which is obviously, I know you can't comment because it's a political decision, but nonetheless it will be predicated upon the trends within some of the data that you've just been highlighting.
Exactly. Yeah. So I think back in May in the MTFS, the government had a central scenario of pay awards for this year being 3.5%, and it's turned out to be 6.5%.
Yep.
And in total this year, they estimate that's about £800 million more of spending pressure relative to what they had thought. And that's because inflation is higher. So, and this is a really difficult thing to balance between, if you've got high inflation, how do you continue to reward public servants and pay them a wage that is not being eroded by inflation? But if pay is half your budget and your budget is not going up that much, then where do you make the adjustment? And that either has to be in reprioritising spending, or it has to be in terms of headcount in the public sector.
OK, thank you. It's very helpful.
OK, thank you. Michael, to be followed by John.
Thanks, Camilla. Just to stick with the public sector workforce for a little while, I suppose it's the status or the policy of government that I'm interested in, and how that's informed what you've done in terms of the numbers that you've produced. So we had the resource spending review, which was a major piece of work back in May 2022, that said that it would reduce aim to return the total size of the devolved public sector workforce to around pre-COVID levels by 2026-27. Mm-hmm. We were promised more detail on that in the budget last year. John Swinney then didn't provide that, said that was up to bodies to provide. I asked on 16th of May the Permanent Secretary the status of that policy. He said, do I think it's been publicly stated? Essentially, he didn't know what the status of it was. Shona Robson told this committee on 13th of June it's a bit of a blunt tool. She was abandoning RSR. But then in recent days, we've had much more of the language about a big decrease in public sector workforce. So what's your understanding of the policy situation that the Scottish Government are putting in place, and how has that informed the predictions and assumptions you've made?
Yeah. So in our forecast, so we take essentially the current kind of estimates of public sector employment, and then we use that an assessment about public sector pay in our tax and economy forecasts. So, and the protocol that we have with the government is that they should give us essentially a final pay policy and public sector employment policy. And that doesn't mean a specific, exact details. It can be relatively broad brush in that context. We didn't have a final
pay policy from government. We've developed our own, which I can explain about what we've done for that, but we don't have a specific final policy from the government.
So was there a reason for them not providing that?
They'll be in negotiations and thinking about their plans, etc. It doesn't really matter too much for us in terms of our forecast, but we don't have a final pay policy, for example, in our forecast from the government. And that's ultimately for them to finalise over the coming months. What we've done, and again, we've been quite open with government as we've been doing this so that they know what we're doing. We essentially have, in our modelling, a 3% average pay award, and that's based on the fact that we think inflation is 3% next year. Adding in pay progression takes us about 4.5%. So that's what's in our modelling, as in our assumption, is a 4.5% pay for the pay award for the public sector. As I was just saying to Ms Smith there, that is greater than the overall resource budget projection for next year. So that leads to essentially, I guess, three implications for that. One is that pay that we have in there is too big relative to what will ultimately transpire. Secondly, that it requires that other areas of the budget, so the other half of the budget, will have to take up more of the slack in order to pay for that above the total resource increase in the budget, or public sector employment would need to fall.
So what percentage of the overall budget is pay?
It's just over, in terms of the resource budget, I think it's just over half. Claire, if Claire can maybe come in.
I mean, that's my understanding.
Yes. So it's, yeah, sorry, Claire, on you go.
The Scottish Government have estimated that pay accounts for £25 billion of the resource budget in the current financial year, so that's just over half.
And you requested a pay policy for them. You said that that's one of your requirements, and they didn't provide you with a policy or an indication as to what they were doing on pay.
Well, so the protocol requires that they give us a final pay policy.
By when?
Well, it's in the it's part of the round forecast. So by the final forecast, our final round three forecast, we would normally expect to have a final pay policy and public sector employment policy from the government.
When would that be, Graham? Sorry.
Look at the timelines. The timeline is set out in our document.
If she wants to come in.
So as part of the protocol, we have a deadline for economy moving measures, and that is just over 2 weeks before the budget. So the government needs to provide us with that information by that deadline. And that process is agreed with the government when we get notification of the budget.
It just didn't do it. The government just didn't support. Were there any other documents it didn't supply by the deadline that they'd previously agreed to supply?
A couple of things. So one is the point about pay and public sector employment is that in the absence of a definitive position from the government, then essentially we come up with a judgment which we share with the government, and they have an opportunity to object to it and say that that's completely wildly different from where we are. So in many ways, that I'm relatively relaxed that we have something which we think is broadly in line with a good assessment about what public sector pay and what public sector employment would look like. Clearly, it's then up to, because what we're really interested in is the macro effects of that. The intricacies of the exact numbers are ultimately up to the government. And there's, I understand, a bit careful negotiations with trade unions and the like.
You've worked back on the basis of that in terms of you've made an assumption and you've calculated. And so what assumption have you made about the size of the public sector workforce as a result of the budget constraints and using that number of 3%?
So we have, Claire, do you have that to hand, or is that maybe something we can write?
I think we estimate it fall by 1.5% in 2024-25.
We'll get the exact number for you.
About,
Claire.
About 7,000?
That would be 3%.
3%?
Yeah. If we can get you, I'd rather give you an exact number rather than give you one that
It feels like a pretty major. But within any of that, you have not taken any account of a policy objective. So previously, the Scottish Government had a policy objective that they'd set out in the resource spending review. It's your understanding that's been abandoned. But essentially, what you've had is some media reports, so you've just gone on the numbers?
Well, I think so. So to be clear, what we don't have is the government have not given us, here is our pay policy and public sector employment policy for next year, and this is the exact numbers, please use them. So what we've done then is make a judgment which we think is reasonable around what we think is a reasonable macro forecast for next year. And that's where we look at inflation, we see 3%, add on progression that comes to 4.5% and use that through. But we haven't had it. We don't have an exact particular policy on that regard.
OK, thank you. And my question there, I'm not sure I've got a specific answer about, is there anything else in the agreement with government that they agreed to provide and then did not provide by the deadline?
So we've got everything we needed to do to make our forecasts. And I'm entirely confident in our forecasts that we have everything that we need in order to make the forecast. You'll see just under, there's a discussion about the process behind the forecasts. I think on it's my document, page 23, just right at the start of chapter one. And there's a table underneath there about headline dates. And you'll see there that the government missed the deadline for providing final policy recommendations to us. So our final deadline for policy recommendations was the 5th of December. We agreed to extend that deadline to the 8th of December because we didn't have final decisions from the government. And then there was a second extension for a small element of policy that took us through to the 13th of December. And we do highlight in there, again, we're really transparent about that because I think it's really important that we are transparent about that, we have a protocol and these deadlines are there to be adhered to.
To be met,
yeah,
yes.
And they weren't. I understand how difficult setting budgets are. There's a condensed timeline, really difficult decisions around that. And that's why we were happy as the Independent Fiscal Authority to be accommodating to the government on that. That has had impacts on us in terms of the amount of time we've been able to spend on writing the documents, etc. But ultimately, at the end of the day, am I comfortable with the forecast? Yes. But being honest and transparent, the deadlines have been missed in the protocol.
OK, thank you. I've got a couple of other small issues and move on, if that's OK. Around the social security spend, we are looking at fairly large increases, which you've already set out. I wondered if you could talk about what the relative amount of the uplift that's a result of behaviour change as a result of policy in Scotland. So a lot of talk about a kinder policy, a more generous policy. How much of that is based on assumptions about the intent of that, and how much of it is based on experience? So have you been provided by figures by Social Security Scotland, and are you basing this on modelling about the increase, or is it just your broad assumptions about the policy intent?
Yeah. So there are a few things.
Well, just to respond to your question, at the moment, for things like ADP, there were so many changes made, and it's only relatively recently been introduced. We haven't been able to track through in any detail all the impacts of that on, as you call it, behaviour. All we can say is that at the moment, we haven't seen anything in the data for the number of awards being granted that goes against our initial judgments that we made when we produced the forecast. So although I can't say all our judgments have been fully borne out, equally we haven't seen anything that contradicts in any significant way those initial judgments we made. And I think it will be quite a while before we have enough data to be able to fully understand all the implications of the reforms that were made to ADP by the Scottish Government.
So there's a couple of interesting bits. So if there's a figure 5.9 where we look at ADP and you look at the relative applications between Scotland and the rest of in Scotland and England and Wales, and you do see a spike in the pilot and the national launch, taking us ahead of the gap between ourselves and England and Wales. And again, that's the type of data we're tracking. So we assumed that this would happen. It has happened
The question is whether this unwind or whether it continue to be there. So that's the type of information that Social Security Scotland give us. And there's, I have to say that the support we get from them in terms of providing this data really, you know, has meant that we've been able to make, you know, tweaks to our forecasts. So we've changed, for example, on child disability payment. For example, we've seen a big spike in applications on that. So we've uplifted our forecast on that. But they've given us evidence about average payment, which is slightly lower, so we can change that around at the margins. But to answer your very first question about what's the difference between it, around, roughly speaking, around about half of the gap that you see in the between spend and the block grant adjustment by the end of the period is from new payments, so things which are things like Scottish Child Payment, carer supplement, these things. And the other half is from what we think is the changes in behaviours, the different type of system, which is running ahead of the equivalent system that exists in England and Wales.
OK. And where a lot of the casework that I'm getting in this area is about people who are just not getting decisions on adult disability payment. And it's huge delays. I'm doing some work on this. It would look like longer delays than the DWP and actually the processing of some of this. Do you feel like you're getting sufficient data as a result of that, and these large delays?
Yeah, so what we're seeing, I think, is we're seeing delays and then we're seeing the acceleration of that. So there's certain points in time, the data that we track, you see backlog, and Social Security Scotland are very good with us and saying, look, there is high caseload coming in, there's a backlog here. So you might see a spike, and that's due to us processing applications that have been delayed rather than there's some other reason for this spike. So we do track it, and it's the sort of thing that we then use to help inform the modelling that we do.
But one interesting fact we got from discussions with Social Security Scotland was that when people were told they could provide a lot of information in support of their claim, they tended to assume that Social Security Scotland already had that information. Well, you're part of the government, you must have all these figures. So their assumption was that Social Security already had a lot of that information. So they had to then go away and get that information themselves from other sources. So that was part of the reasons why the delays are somewhat longer. There was a misunderstanding about who actually held the evidence, and an assumption was made by a lot of people that the government already knew these numbers.
And my final question on a different area again, going back to previous questions, was really about, I suppose, this. And I agree with colleagues in terms of that this is such a tiny amount of money, £8 million from the very top rate being realised by this increase. Is it worth the risk? Is it worth all the risks that you've set out in terms of the reputation of the country, about attraction, you know, is it worth doing?
I think that's for politicians and policymakers.
Okay, I thought I'd give it a try.
It's always worth flying these kites, but you know, Graham's switched on, even when these are coming to him in his direction. Okay, John, to be followed by Jamie.
Thanks so much, convener. Probably to touch mainly on points that have been raised to some extent already. Going forward, it looks like, I mean, you've explained why Scotland's earnings have been ahead of the UK's last couple of years, current year. But going forward, you're assuming, am I right in saying, that that will continue to be the case? And if so, is there a danger that that's being a little bit optimistic?
Just to be clear, what we're looking at is the forecast we're making of earnings in Scotland compared to the forecasts that the OBR are making for earnings in the rest of the UK. Now, we have a table in our report where we show that the forecasts that other people have been making for earnings in the rest of the UK are somewhat closer to our estimates of the forecast for earnings growth in Scotland. So we have highlighted in the report that there is a risk that the OBR might revise their estimates for growth of earnings in the rest of the UK, and that could come a lot closer to our estimates for the growth in Scotland. So the gap is not between our forecasts of earnings in Scotland and our forecast of earnings in the rest of the UK. It's the gap between our forecast of earnings in Scotland and OBR's forecast of earnings in the rest of the UK. So it's two different forecasts in that sense.
OK, but there certainly is a risk that we don't continue as we have been in the last couple of years.
One bit about that, though, is, again, just to get the magnitudes in line, I think, again, we've been playing around with numbers. If the earnings growth toward the end of the forecast horizon was to align between Scotland and the UK, that would reduce the net tax position by about £500 million, but the net tax position would still be positive. Mm-hmm. And it comes back to the point about, because of the successive changes and the progressive system, the net tax position is moving, become more and more positive. So even if there's alignment in earnings, there will still be a positive net tax position because of the higher earnings that are now taking place across Scotland and the UK.
Yes, because in the past it's almost the opposite that happened. I mean, the forecasts were quite large negative tax reconciliations, which then became, thankfully, a bit smaller.
Yeah.
So are we kind of going into the opposite situation where you're thinking at the moment there's going to be quite big positive reconciliations and that might well reduce?
Yeah, so I think there's a couple of things. So if you recall, the reason why the net tax position was negative is because Scotland was lagging the UK economically. That was, we talked about that, oil and gas, etc. And that happened. And the net tax positions by a negative are very small positive relative to what they should have been. What we're saying is that if you look at last year and this year, the earnings potential in Scotland's relative economic performance, but crucially on earnings, is now better than the UK. So that is then that's why we're now saying yes, there's a positive reconciliation kicking in, because earnings are so growing so much across Scotland and the UK. Picking up David's kind of rules of thumb there, that's making those numbers much bigger than we were saying they would likely be in May. So if you recall back in May, and even December last year, we were saying that the net tax positions would shift up. But what's happening is, because earnings are so much, they're going even higher there. So that's where we are this year, and we think that will continue into next year. Where the divergence that David is talking about, or the risk, is toward the end of the forecast horizon, where there's that difference between ourselves and the OBR, and a difference, you know, between the OBR and other forecasters in the UK. And if that narrows, then the net tax position that we're projecting will be lower, so the uplift in the revenue budget will be lower than what we've got in the report just now, and that's a risk that we highlight to the budget in terms of when they're planning.
Okay, the figure of £668 million, I think it is, has been mentioned already. It's just 3.5% of Scottish income tax revenues, which is, you say, a relatively small shift in terms of income tax forecast. And I accept that 3.5% is, you know, if we could forecast most things within 3.5%, that would be fine. However, that is a very big figure when it comes to what we are allowed to have in reserves or borrow. Mm-hmm. And so I think, I mean, while you seem to be quite relaxed about it, I mean, do you understand that for us and the government, that is quite a worrying figure?
Yeah, and this is one of the quirks of the framework, in that you're dealing with movements in two very large numbers. So movements in very large numbers can lead to differences that seem small, but actually turn out to be really quite significant when you're managing the budget. And all the risk to manage that there is on the Scottish Government in terms of managing that. That in some ways, I think, has informed the fiscal framework review, so lifting up the borrowing requirements on resource, giving greater flexibility in the Scotland Reserve about what it can be used for, etc. So these numbers have been increased. I guess the point that I think is really important, and it will be really important for both governments to continue to keep an eye on, these limits will be increased by inflation, so that will help as inflation continues to go up. But you'll want to look at whether you've got the management tools to manage the risk that exists here. And I come back to that point that in 2017-2018, income tax revenues were £10.9 billion. We project by the end of the period there'll be £23 billion. So these numbers are going to get bigger in the future, simply because we're now dealing with bigger levels of income tax.
John, before you ask a further question, Claire, what's coming?
Can you hear me now? Yes. I just wanted to add that we're currently in a period where we're seeing a positive improvement in the income tax net position. And at the same time, we're seeing these forecasts of positive income tax reconciliations. But those two things aren't a given that they will happen at the same time, because the reconciliation is about the relative forecast error. So we may still see, even when we've got a period of time with a more positive income tax net position, we could still have negative income tax reconciliations in the future. It's just that the current two income tax reconciliations that we're forecasting are basically picking up a period of time where we didn't quite capture the improvement in Scottish income tax revenues. So it's almost like the lag in the improvement is why we're then seeing these positive income tax reconciliations. And in the future, it could be that we're actually better forecasting Scottish revenues, and the OBR is accurately forecasting UK revenues, and the relative error that happens might mean that we could have a negative income tax reconciliation while we have a period of time with a large positive income tax net position.
Okay, that's helpful, thanks. Now, again, another point that's been raised is the whole question of multi-year forecasting. And am I right in understanding then it's because really the UK government linked to the OBR has not really been very specific in their forecasting, like with departments, that you've really not been able to, and neither you nor the Scottish Government can make accurate forecasts multi-year?
Well, so we can make the forecast for multi-year in terms of the revenues, and we can take what the UK government have said broad brush about the block grant, and we can use that. So we can make multi-year forecasts. I guess the government's argument is that while there's uncertainty about net tax position or uncertainty about what the UK government might do, so we're only doing 1 year of budget. We do say in the report, and as the independent fiscal institution, we think that's disappointing, in that the government should set out multi-year spending plans, and they should, you know, because there's uncertainty, that in many ways means that they should do more to set out how you will manage potential variability in these elements going forward. So I think I would always be an advocate for government doing multi-year plans. We could then do much more, for example. So if you look at our table of portfolio spending, I think is it figure one, we can only do 1 year because we don't have anything beyond that.
So is it almost inevitable, or do you think the Scottish Government could have done more forecasting despite the lack of information?
Yeah. I mean, there's nothing. Yeah, I mean, they could do much more. And then obviously clearly put the uncertainties and the caveats around it. But there's nothing to stop people doing multi-year forecasts. The similar thing for the UK, it's the same thing. There's nothing to stop the UK government setting out spending review, you know, projections beyond what they've done at the moment.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But obviously a change of government at UK level could change quite a lot.
Yeah, and again, that's one of the risks, again, we highlight, is that clearly this is based upon projections before a UK general election, and a future UK government may have a different opinion about how to manage the UK public finances and in turn impact upon the block grant.
OK. Ms Murder?
Thank you. I was just going to add, we have published 5-year forecasts of the Scottish Government's funding position for resource and capital. So they're set out in real nominal terms as growth rates in our report, and in supplementary tables, we have the cash figures as well. So we have published those alongside the budget. And I'd also just add that the UK government not publishing detailed departmental spending plans is not unusual within they publish for a spending review, and beyond that, they don't publish that. It's not an unusual position. It's not an ideal position, and it does make it more difficult for the Scottish Government. But it's also normal that until you get to the next spending review, you've only got the current spending review period of spending plans. So just to give that context.
Okay, thanks again for that. And then on social security, I mean, we've talked to Michael Mara and yourselves talked a little about the demand and the Scottish system being different from the UK system. Mm-hmm. Your assumptions going forward, I mean, this year I think we're increasing 6.7%, which is in line with inflation. Is that your assumption going forward, that will continue to be the case?
In terms of uprating?
Yes.
Yeah, so our assumption is that we uprate most of the benefits by CPI inflation based in September of the preceding year. And then the main thing, we've not really changed And government hasn't really changed the policies within the social security. So the numbers are broadly similar to the drivers of the numbers are broadly similar to what they were last time. What is driving the numbers is changes in inflation, so higher inflation, but also picking up trends in disability claims across the UK. Okay. So that's the main reason why the numbers have been increasing.
So it's a Do you want to come in, Mr.
What we have seen is UK-wide increases in applications for disability benefits, not just in Scotland. And our last report, we said those were driven by poor health after COVID, increasing waiting lists in the NHS, and cost of living pressures. The OPR in their latest report have said they've looked again at this and they think that cost of living pressures are more dominant in explaining this increase in demand across the whole of the UK. So obviously as cost of living pressures ease, as inflation falls, that factor will tend to fall away. So it doesn't affect the immediate forecast for Social Security, but we do say that we think it won't grow so fast in the future because of this diminishing impact of the cost of living.
And looking at it finally from another angle, I mean, when I look at the figures quickly in the budget, there's a lot of areas are being restricted and the Social Security is going up by about £1 billion. From an economic point of view, does it matter, you know, where the government spends that £1 million? I mean, would it have a different impact on the economy and growth and so on if that billion was spent, say, in housing or education? Or does it not really matter? Is that not something you look at?
So we don't get into the detail of like alternative policy options. To be honest, I don't, David may have a different view on this. You get into questions about different fiscal multipliers and what's the relative spend, impact of different spend. And to be honest, in a short-term forecast, most of them will wash out to one another. And it's more about the broader objectives that the government might have. In the long run, you get some really interesting questions about if you tackle poverty, what might be the potential benefits to the economy and economic growth over multi-years, similar to the conversation we were having about tax. But for the purposes of like forecasting what happens next year in the economy, it's not something we look at. And to be honest, I don't really think it would have too much of an impact on our immediate forecast.
Right. But one point to add is that it's always worthwhile bearing in mind that Social Security spending is essentially demand-led. So once you've set all the policies for how people can apply for Social Security, once you've set the levels of remuneration they get depending on their conditions, once that's set, the amount you actually end up spending on Social Security is not under the government's control. That depends on the number of people who choose to go and apply and get Social Security. So you cannot change that number from one year to the next the way you can just decide we'll cut spending on housing or we'll cut spending on education. Once you've set the policies on Social Security, essentially the spending is out of your hands for quite a number of years until you introduce new reforms here.
Yes, I mean, I do understand that, but the government could change the policy and say...
It could change the policy, but... It's just worthwhile remembering that a lot of this is set in motion by decisions that were made a few years ago. You don't have the same luxury of tinkering at the margin.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks, I understand that. Right. Okay, thanks, Kevin.
Thanks, John. Jamie.
Thanks very much. I'm very conscious of time. So I was just going to go into ask again about some of the tax side of it. Graham, this morning you were talking, I think, on the radio about the marginal rates and highlighting them, 43,000 to 54,000, a marginal rate of 54. I understand that's going to come down, and obviously we've talked earlier about the 100k to 125k and up to nearly 70%. I was wondering if you could kind of give comment or concerns or thoughts on that.
So the issue we're talking about here is what happens when Scottish devolved income tax policies interact with UK reserve tax policies with national insurance and what happens to the personal allowance. And you have this quirk where national insurance goes from 12% to 2% when you go above, when you move into the equivalent of the UK higher rate. But clearly, because the Scottish higher rate starts earlier, you've got people who are paying the higher rate of income tax in Scotland, but also the core rate of national insurance, and that's why you get this marginal tax rate of above 50%. And then the same thing happens when you get up to 100,000. At the UK level, you start to lose the personal allowance, so that increases the marginal tax rate for every pound of income that you earn. But that's also where, because of the interactions with the new 75,000 rate in Scotland, you're now paying more on top of that, and that's where you get up to that nearly 70% marginal tax rate. So that, and people, and I guess the question comes back to the conversation we've had, is that if someone is thinking about, do you work overtime, do you work an extra day, do you you know, take on an additional role, do you put more money into your pensions, all those sorts of things are really determined by this marginal rate. And if the marginal rate is higher, then people might take different decisions, so they might not work that extra day if they're only going to get half the pay that they would, you know, for the gross pay would say they'd be entitled to.
And in terms of those two rates there, I mean, we're looking at, say, a very different, you know, very different kind of salary bands, as it were, or on that side. Would the lower one be more likely, would you expect to see behavioural change because it's perhaps a larger part of income?
It's interesting to get David's reflections. I think, yes, it might be a larger part of your income, but the way this works, acts because it's more progressive, you actually end up taking more out as you go up. But also, what typically happens is it's people at the top end of the income distribution that have the greatest flexibility to change their behaviours. They have the ability to maybe take some money and become incorporated. They have an opportunity to put more money into a private pension. They have an opportunity not to take on an additional role. A lot of the people who will be in this brand between 43,500 and 50,000 will be people on PAYE, where you work 35 hours a week, and your additional pay award that you've got at the end of this year is now going to be worth less because of this increase, because you're maybe more of your income might be being taxed at the higher rate.
So less of a flexibility, David, I don't know if you wanted to come in on that.
Yeah, just to bear up that point, that we tend to think about individuals being able to choose lots of things about how they work and where they work. But for many people, this is actually set by their employer. They don't have that choice. And when I was on the NHS pay review body, we talked to nurses who were working phenomenal hours, not because of any considerations of tax, but because they loved the job.
Yeah.
And that's what drove them to work the hours they work. So you've got to bear in mind that we're really quite complex factors which drive people's decisions.
Can I just ask as well, I mean, say we talked about the behavioural changes that people can or can't make depending on their circumstances, but obviously if, for example, people on that higher rate are choosing to work less, or they're choosing to incorporate, or they're whatever choices they're making, they're working less or putting more into pensions, that's potentially money coming out of local spending in their local economies. Is there any way of modelling that, or is there any way that that can be identified or forecast?
Well, you need enormous data sources to be able to do that, because the problem is that the way people can respond to tax is so complex. There are so many dimensions to it. And I've referred before to what we tend to look at is just taxable income, but that can be the outcome of many, many decisions that people make. And for high earners, that could also involve decisions around sort of complex avoidance schemes as well. These people will be very well informed, but often working in the city, they may know all the schemes themselves.
Yeah.
So there's lots of dimensions along which people can move. So there is a difference there between decisions people make which affects the level of GNP, because if people are not working so much, they're not producing so much. People who are using avoidance to avoid tax, they're still working hard, so there's still a lot of activity taking place in the economy. It's just not getting translated into tax in the same way. So the implication between the impact of behaviour on the economy and the impact on taxable revenue can be somewhat different. Okay.
And I suppose my last question I was going to ask, this morning Giles Souza was talking after you actually on the BBC, and he recognised that, you know, we won't know some of the tax implications of this budget for about 2.5 years, and he said he had sympathy with you having to forecast based on some of the difficulties. You know, we now have a number of different bands. We have some of these marginal tax rates. We're not going to know the information for a bit of time. How does that impact on your ability to forecast, and what are the kind of dangers of that in terms of accurate forecasting?
When we do our forecast, we're, the key thing for us is essentially the accuracy of the earnings data that we can get and the projections for that going forward. That's ultimately key, because then we can then put it through our modelling, and it captures that relatively well. And we've talked about in our forecast evaluation report the increasing weight that we're putting onto this real-term, this RTI data. And I think when the OBR were up here talking earlier this month or late last month, they were also talking about how the RTI data is much improved. There have been real concerns about the labour market data across the UK. So the RTI data is the key bit for us to look at. So that's the bit which I think is the most important. There's always going to be uncertainties. And I think the concern that we had last year when we talked about our forecast evaluation is the one thing we do not have any information on at all is self-assessment. So we do, we just don't have that. That's not something that we get and we can get. And you could argue that if you create a more complex tax system, and particularly, again, people, as David was saying, who can be more flexible, are going to be using things like self-assessment and things much more in a much more significant way than maybe a standard PAYE system, that might mean that you might see more money and income coming through self-assessment. And that's the bit that that's the dark bit of the forecast that we just can't see into. So there's potential risk for us there.
Okay.
Just to add that all forecasts are essentially very aggregate macro level forecasts. So it's the forecast of the economy, the forecast of average earnings. We don't get down to the kind of micro level to forecast the stuff that would pick up some of the effects that you're talking about. So some of these details about precise marginal tax rates don't matter terribly much in terms of driving our forecasts on tax revenue.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Jamie. That's a concluded question for committee. But just a couple of points I want to add on. I just want to go on and try and pin this behavioural response thing down a wee bit, because in terms of you know, paragraph 35 of your report, you know, you talk about 200 million gross and 82 million net, but we know that of the net, 74 million comes from a £75,000 new band, and the 8 million from the 125,140 kind of band. But where is the gross in those two? So is that 8 million out of 40 million, or 8 million out of 60 million, whatever? So it's just to try and find, to get a better idea where the tipping point is. You know what I mean? Because so if you think, so I remember being in the Basque Country many years ago, and they said that if you put income tax up 2 or 3% more than the Spanish average, it doesn't make much difference. But then you get 4%, 5%, suddenly it goes, you know, the kind of reverse laughter curve, so to speak. So that's what I'm trying to say. So if you're looking at the gross 200 million, how much of that 200 million is from the 126, 125, 140, and how much from the 75,000?
So I think when we're talking about the gross, probably the easiest thing to think about is this, what we call it, the static effect. So that's essentially when there's no behavioural effect. So
indeed,
if you make it all the way to page 117 of our report, you'll be doing well. But there is a line in there.
Didn't he only got it at half 5?
Yeah. So there is a line in there where we talk about the static effect. So we talk about how the advanced threshold rate would be raised about 147 million. And that's before the behavioural effect, and the change in the top, the additional penny, is 53 million. So that's probably the easiest to think of in terms of gross, if you can use that term, of just no change in behaviour. That's essentially what these revenues would raise.
Right, so basically you're saying out of the 143 million then, you'll generate 74 million, which is slightly over 50%.
Yeah.
But from the 57 million, you're only generating 8 million, which is probably about 13%.
Yeah, and that again,
that's interesting.
Yeah, and that's again consistent, because
if you go to the top end of the distribution, that's where you have the greatest ability to change your extensive and intensive margins, and that's where the big behavioural bit comes okay. through.
Well, I did get to page 96, and that's land buildings and transaction tax. And the reason I'm asking about that is no one's touched on that. And what we're looking at is a quite a significant decline between this year from 813 to 730 million is the prediction. So that's an 83 million deficit, which incidentally is £1 million more than these projected increases in tax from these two rates we've just talked about. But then you go on to look at residential tax over the next 4 years, going up by about 56, 57%, just doing the sums in my head. So I'm just wondering if you can briefly just talk us through this. I know that I can see from paragraph 4.88, you suggested that house prices would rise you know, in 22-23 by 6% in transactions, 10.8%, but in actual fact, house prices rose a wee bit more than that in transactions, a bit less. Mm-hmm. So I'm just wondering if you can talk us through this land buildings transaction tax, because it's a significant amount of money,
yep.
and it's a significant decrease going forward into the next financial year.
Yeah, so you're right. So we're still predicting that the total amount of revenue collected will decline. And in large part, again, that's we're predicting that last year. What we're predicting is slightly less of a fall than what we were saying last year, so for 24-25, in part because of these updates that we're doing to prices and transactions. Broadly speaking, it doesn't really change the overall profile. So there's a figure 4.24, where you see the path of house prices. And we're now higher, so we lifted it up in May slightly, and we lifted it up again mm-hmm. in December. But the overall trend is that we think that between 2022-2023, when we think that prices will have peaked, there'll have been a decline over the next couple of years, particularly as the effects of mortgages translate through. So, and one of the interesting things is that even though the Bank of England have been increasing interest rates quite significantly, the full effects of that haven't come through because lots of people are on fixed mortgages. Mm-hmm. So it's only when you come off your fixed mortgage do you face this new higher mortgage cost when you remortgage. So again, the legacy effect of higher interest rates feeds through, and that's why we're still predicting a dip, both in prices and transactions.
Yeah, and interest rates are predicted to stay higher for longer. And finally, for me, we saw that there was a 6.7% increase in benefits, the same as the UK increased benefits from their portfolio. I mean, that's obviously good news for people in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment, up to £26.70. But if there's a tipping point in tax, where's the tipping point in terms of social security and labour market participation? Has there been any work done on that?
We haven't done anything on that. I think the one thing I would say is that the Social Security spending payments that we look at that are devolved in Scotland are quite heavily concentrated on people with disability and ill health, or people who are, of all ages.
Mm-hmm.
So they're less of the Social Security payments that you might particularly think there would be an immediate labour market effect, say such as unemployment benefit, job seekers allowance, mm-hmm. Or things like that. So these when we're looking at this, we don't then model this as being an economy moving measure, so we don't think people's incentives are changing, and that's in part because of the nature of the benefits.
Okay, well, thank you very much for responding to our questions so succinctly and directly. I really appreciate that. We're going to have just a 2-minute break while a weird and wonderful collection of individuals known as the Scottish Fiscal Commission will be giving evidence very shortly. On to our second agenda item, which is to take evidence from the Scottish Fiscal Commission on how it delivers its functions. We are joined today by Professor Graeme Roy, Chair, and John Ireland, Chief Executive of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. So I welcome you again, Professor Roy, and to yourself, John. I know you were listening to the first session, the background there, and invite Professor Roy to make a brief opening statement.
Okay, great. And thank you, Convener. First of all, I really welcome the opportunity to speak with you this morning. It's a privilege to be chair of the Scottish Fiscal Commission. I think we have a great team of commissioners and staff dedicated to public service, as demonstrated by their work over the last few weeks under difficult and demanding circumstances. We aim to be a highly transparent organisation, both in terms of our forecasts, analysis and judgments, but also in our governance and operations. Our annual business plans set out our operations, key activities over the previous year and our plans for the year ahead. And our annual accounts show how we are operating within our financial constraints, including operating as a small organisation. A few things to highlight. We're looking forward to our statutory review next year, and we're also looking forward to beginning work on a future round of recruitment for new commissioners who won't be appointed until 2025, but we want to start that work as early as possible. And this is a really big and important piece of work as we look to not only improve the diversity within our commissioner team, but also to develop our skills and experience. And finally, if I can, I just want to thank this committee for your interest in our work. We exist to help government and parliament understand the risks and uncertainties in devolved public finances so that budget can be as transparent and well scrutinised as possible. If there's more that you think we can do to help you with the work, then please, we're more than happy to help.
Well, thank you for that opening statement, Professor Roy. Well, you and I have spoken kind of privately about some of the things you would like to do. I mean, I've read your report. I can't see anything that I would want to criticise you on. You've laid out in detail the potential principal risks, which don't appear to have arisen. So I'm just wondering if there's what additional areas you would like to focus on, if, for example, the review allowed for additional resources in terms of, for example, staff.
Yeah. I think the ultimate function, the most important function of us is delivering the best possible forecast that we can for the budget. And I think that protecting that and importing that is obviously really crucial. The bits of area of expansion, which I think where we can add real value, is around doing more around the fiscal sustainability work. I think that's a crucial issue for Scotland over the long term. And beginning to unpick the big structural questions which will face, you know, future administrations, not just this current one, I think is really vital. And there's no one else doing that in Scotland. I think we have a really important role there. I also think there's an area where we're moving into, which I think is really important. We touched on it in the earlier evidence session around spending and our ability to comment about where spending is moving and what might be the medium-term implications of particular choices within spending portfolios and extending our role into there. So we've started to do more than that, and I think that the more that we can do in that, I think that we can add value. All the time protecting that independence and not commenting specifically on policy choices.
Yes, it's not commenting on policy choices, it's showing what policy choices are available, and then it would be up to politicians to decide whether or not to take one or other forward. Okay, I can see that. Okay, I'm going to open up the session. John, followed by Michael.
Thanks very much. Perhaps to yourself, Mr. Ireland, to start with. You say in the Chief Executive's introduction, we are continuing to work on the public understanding of fiscal policy in Scotland. So I was wondering, is that possible and how's it going?
Yes, it's possible. And I think Graeme's particularly important here, so he might have to add something as well. But I think it really is part of our job to try and help the public understand. But I think we have to be realistic about that. The fiscal framework is, as you know, incredibly complex. However, there's some basic things which I think we can be clear about, and we try to be clear in that in our reporting. We try and structure our reports so they're accessible, and our graphics so they're accessible to a wide range of people. But again, you know, we have to think about where to direct our resources here. So we spend a lot of time thinking not so much about how can we communicate with the public en masse, but how we can communicate with, say, journalists, who then do that communication for us as well. So I think there are things to be done. We're thinking about engagement in a slightly different way. And I think Graeme might want to add something on that now.
I think I think a few things in there. I think one is there's a really important piece of work for us to do about communicating more broadly, but also communicating with the key decision makers that really matter in terms of the big issues we're doing. So we're talking, you know, if you're talking about fiscal sustainability, the organisations that really matter in Scotland around that, like COSLA, like Public Health Scotland, Scottish Government, we're really keen that we do much more with them to articulate and be able to explain the work that we're doing around fiscal sustainability and the like with them. And the conversation we just had about public sector wages is a really good example of, I think, where we can add value, and by just articulating how much of the budget is public sector wages. So if you make choices in wages, that doesn't impact on employment, but also impacts on broader areas as well. So I think there's a lot that we can do with people who are really involved in that process, who are really engaged with that. And we've started to try and do some, and we will do it over the next year, but we started to do some training of people. We explain the budget, we explain the fiscal framework, and our plan is to create a series of bite-sized videos which people can go along. If you're bored on Christmas Day, you can go along and watch a five-minute tutorial on what reconciliations mean. And I think the more we can do on that and work with others to get people to understand, not so much about the detail, but why the numbers matter and what it means for people making these decisions.
OK, thanks. I realise we're kind of tight for time. In the past, data needs, you produced quite a long list, or I think Dame Susan Rice produced quite a long list of data needs, but you're saying now you're only going to publish that every 2 years because you seem to have cracked that, is that right?
I think we're always in the market for data. We're always asking for data. I think there's a point about how regularly we need to keep doing this, and that's why I think we're now into 2 years for that. We've made good strides, I think, in Scotland, particularly in data. I think the big concerns we had when I last spoke about data needs around Social Security, I think we've got a really much better relationship with Social Security Scotland in terms of getting the data that we need. We're always needing more, so we'll update that. And we're also quite happy to say, outside of the regular reporting on data needs, if we have concerns or we're not getting the data that we need, then we'll communicate that through other channels.
OK, thanks. And my final question was, in paragraph 196, it says the SFC is not yet subject to the public sector equality duty. Can you explain why and what's happening there?
I think that's in relation to reporting on the gender pay gaps explicitly, but we voluntarily do report.
Right.
And if you look there, we have a negative median pay gap in the last couple of years, which means that women on average within the organisation are paid more than men.
But you are going to be subject to the public sector.
We will be. I think this sort of it's one of those things where it depends upon your employment size and it sort of squeezes as time goes on. But we took the decision just to voluntarily report that.
Right, okay. That's great. Thanks, Gavin.
Thanks very much. Michael, to be followed by Liz.
Thanks. You also say in the report that you want to make sure the work is clear and accessible. I also wonder about replicable. And particularly, I think, in the run-up to this budget, we've had a couple of external reports trying to cost different taxation policies that have taken pretty markedly different methodologies other than the very key methodology, which is your own. So how much is that a black box that people can't see into, and how much are you engaging with external organisations to show you're working so that they can then essentially plug their own numbers into your formula and we can have a more consistent view of some of those issues around behaviour effects?
So we're very transparent about our numbers. We're also more than happy to engage with people around that. I mean, interestingly, if you take tax as an example, the government publish essentially ready reckoners based on our numbers. So anyone could go in and say, well, what would happen if you put a penny on the top rate of tax? And they would come out with our number, broadly speaking. So I think there is... I think we would encourage people to use that sort of thing because it is there. If people want more information, then we're more than happy to speak with them and to do it. I think you're right. There is, when people come out with different numbers, and it can be quite confusing in that. I think if there's any more that we can do to, you know, promote
the fact that our information is available, then great. If you take our relationship with someone like Fraser Valander is a good example of that. They have their models, we have our models, but our officials communicate, so they know why we might have differences, different assumptions that we're using. So anything is really down to just the nuts and bolts in there. I think it's more potential other ones maybe advocating a policy where you might come out with a different number to us, but hopefully they'll use ours.
So would you be proactive in that? I mean, there's two reports I'm thinking of immediately, the IPPR report, STUC report, both of which have been produced, both of which seem to be pretty markedly different methodologies to your own. Is that something that you would proactively approach them and say, you know, you've made these assumptions, it's a key part of the public debate, it's right that they publish these reports, it's very useful, I think, for all of us.
Yeah.
But actually having that kind of common methodology, or at least an understanding, or even displaying the variance against your own methodology and why they've made some assumptions in that. Something, do you do that proactively?
So I think we would... We're more than happy to engage, and we do engage with organisations like IPPR and others as well on a regular basis. There's always a balance between, particularly in a budget cycle, us proactively going out and saying, you know, and how much time we have, etc., for that. To be fair, I mean, if you read these reports that come out with different numbers, they do talk about all the issues around behaviour, and they do talk about the work that we've done, etc. They then may choose to use the static costings or to use a more... a generous assessment on the elasticities, and I guess ultimately that's their judgment in there, and I guess I wouldn't be critical of them doing that, but there's a broader question about how do you communicate all that when you've got quite different numbers moving around.
Last question, if that's okay, can be. Sure. There's the budget for economic and scientific advice published yesterday, I think has almost doubled for the Scottish Government in 2 years. Do you get a cut of that? For your own,
we have. I'll get John to explain. We have our own budget line.
Our budget is comes from the finance portfolio, and it's in the budget document. We have an agreement with the government in our framework document that we get 3 years worth of get the amount for the next financial year is in the budget. The following 2 years, the cabinet secretary will write to us after the budget bill is passed, giving us an indicative allocation, which has been in line with what we've asked for the past. So all the time that we've been independent body, but we're not funded as part of the government's economic advice, no.
And do you think that represents an increasing cost for that advice, or for the Scottish Government? I suppose this is getting back into a previous conversation about budget scrutiny in some respects, but I'm just wondering in terms of your own budget and the flex you need to do that work.
In terms of our budget, the number of people we have working for us has increased over time as we've done more. So, for example, the fiscal sustainability work, with your support, we asked the government for more resource to do that. So, in a sense, you know, our resources have increased in line with the work that we're doing. We're very careful in how much money we ask for. And I think at the moment our resources are sufficient to do what we do. One of the issues that we do have, though, of course, is labour market churn. People come and work for us. They tend to be quite young, and they'll move on, and that leaves us with vacancies. And that is always an issue for us managing vacancies. But the overall funding we have from the government, I think, is fair and adequate.
OK.
Just a very quick suggestion, if you could repeat that wonderful lunchtime seminar that you did for MSPs and staff about 4 months ago, I think it was, with all your diagrams, which is... far, far better than reading through an awful lot of text. It was fantastic and much appreciated by the staff in the Parliament.
Very kind of yes, more than happy to.
Yeah. It clashed with the SNP group meeting, which is why a lot of us were not there. But what I would say is that the kind of early morning breakfast, kind of half eight bacon roll type seminars are also very useful, not only for MSPs but also for members of staff. I think they've been very helpful, and I'm certainly keen to see them continue.
Yeah.
So, any other? I know, John, you've got to rush to the chamber. You've got to be there for 2 o'clock, and of course, we can't meet after 2 o'clock, and it's 2:55 now. So, unless anyone's got anything else they want to ask, I'm going to call this session to a halt. I want to thank you again, Professor Roy, and also John Ireland, for your evidence today. It's been very helpful in our deliberations. And apart from that, I just want to close the meeting and wish everyone a very Merry Christmas and a happy and peaceful New Year. So, thanks.